If I had a dollar from YouTube whenever somebody writes on my channel that the link is slow, I guess I wouldn't need to open a Patreon account. This opinion tells two things about anyone who believes in it. 1. They don't know LINQ. 2. They never measured it. So in this video we shall behave like engineers. We shall learn a LINQ and we shall measure its performance. What else is there to do? If you plan to leave me now, let me tell you the result. People are slow, LINQ is fast. I will divide this video into 3 benchmarks. In the opening one, we shall measure the performance of finding a maximum in a list of integers. There will be a list containing 100,000 integers. Then we need to find the maximum. If I wanted to be like someone who avoids a LINQ all day long, I would probably take an approach similar to what we would do in C some 50 years ago. Make the first element the current maximum, that is the false position method in programming, iterate through the rest of the list starting at index 1, update the current maximum every time. Once the loop terminates, the variable will contain the actual maximum of the list. I wouldn't complain about the performance of this loop up front. Still, I will compare it to LINQ, where the maximum is calculated via the max operator. LINQ will be the baseline. I will tell you straight that the LINQ variant is several times faster. Not because I want to spoil the surprise, but because I want to point out that looping through the list, however attractive, is not the best course of action if you aim for performance. It's already commonplace in .NET to use spans instead. Therefore, I would obtain a read-only span and then repeat the rest of the algorithm on that object. Since the span is a local variable, the JIT compiler will be able to optimize out the bounds checks. This approach should definitely be faster. I'm running the benchmark and here you can see the results. The barrel loop is a staggering 4 times slower than the LINQ max operator. Did you expect to see that? A span is much faster as expected, but it is still more than 2 times slower than LINQ. Why is that? I mean, isn't the span the fastest way to iterate over memory? Well, not exactly. There are even faster ways which you can find in the max operator implementation. This is the .NET Source Browser website, a very useful tool I frequently use. Let's find the enumerable class in the system.link namespace. It consists of many partial classes. Let me find the max implementation. Here it is. Max comes with many overloads. Shockingly, int and long are implemented separately. Well, that looks like optimization. Let's see where the int implementation will take us. I want to make it clear why we are here. We are here because we are looking for a way to improve the performance of a loop. It took me 4 lines of code that operate on a span, but here I see something like 20-30 lines of code doing the same thing in LINQ. That already hints that this code will beat mine. It operates on an enumerable, yet it tries to pull out a span. That may or may not succeed, depending on the underlying collection. Still, there will be a span for my list. LINQ is already doing at least as much as I did manually. I don't think I will ever beat this code. But then it checks whether there is hardware acceleration. Well, that is interesting. With no hardware acceleration, the max operator would essentially do the same thing I did in that loop. Well, this makes my code look like a puppet. My best implementation is only the fallback option for a LINQ. Way down in the else branch, we see what the LINQ will actually do when there is hardware acceleration, which I believe exists on my laptop. This block of code is dark magic. I believe my call to max ended up doing this. If you ever wanted to beat a LINQ, learn to write code like this. The very last else branch covers the case when there is no span for the collection. This is the good old enumerator. I will use this same approach in the next benchmark. For a LINQ, it is just another fallback position. This code unveils the mystery of how LINQ can run in only a fraction of the time of my best effort based on spans. However, this benchmark does not reflect reality as we know it. It assumes the existence of a list before the operation. Well, I have something to say about that. I will write it down as a reminder. Lists, they don't grow on trees, they grow on heaps. So if I planned to iterate through the list, I would need to construct and populate the list first. This benchmark covers the case when we iterate the same list multiple times, so we avoid the cost of creating the list in subsequent operations. Let's start a new benchmark for the case when the list does not exist yet. There is no way to execute a for loop on a non-existent list. I would need to create the list first by enumerating the numbers and adding them to the list. Only then do I repeat the maximum algorithm. Now you see the problem. What if nobody else uses this list after this code terminates? Why did I create it? It was a wasted effort. That is one of the most important lessons about collections. You don't create them if you won't use them again. So here is my next attempt on the same data source, which is just an enumerable. That is a lazily evaluated sequence of numbers. I will use a while loop over an enumerator to iterate the sequence without ever collecting it into a list. Take the first element as the winner, enumerate for the remainder of the sequence, updating the current maximum. Once the loop consumes the entire sequence, the max variable will contain the maximum value. Then comes the LINQ version, which is again just data.max. The benchmark will be ruthless. Not only is the for loop the slowest, but the difference is even greater than before. That is because of the added cost of creating the list. There is another red flag here. The for loop collects all the data into memory before processing them. The other two implementations consume very little memory, only for the current state. The collection, however, will take as much memory as there are data. That could be hundreds of bytes or hundreds of megabytes or gigabytes if you are unlucky. Also note that the while loop's running time is identical to that of the LINQ operator. You will hardly ever be able to beat a LINQ on a lazy evaluated sequence. All you will ever be able to accomplish is to do the same thing a LINQ does. Still, you may complain that evaluating a simple operator on a primitive data type doesn't prove much about a LINQ. So let's move to the third and the last benchmark in which I will evaluate a more complex operation. Before that, let me point out that you can download this code and the code from all other videos on my channel from my Patreon page. This channel is free thanks to the patrons. Now here is the request. Start from a list of random integer numbers. Isolate blocks consisting of 6 consecutive digits from inside every number in the style of a sliding window. Then count the appearances of each such block. Identify the 10 most frequent blocks of 6 digits. This sounds like a search algorithm. Let's set up the list. Now that the list is there, we have a CPU-bound algorithm to implement. I will implement it in the form of another for loop. You can pause the video at any point and read the code carefully. A dictionary will map blocks of digits into their counts, loop through the list, take the current value and then start extracting 6-digit blocks. Any block not starting with 0 has 6 digits. See how many of those are already in the dictionary? Increase that by 1. Remove the last digit to emulate the sliding window technique. This loop will give me the count for all the digit blocks. But I need the most frequent ones, so I will pull all the candidate numbers into an array, sort it descending by the counts of individual blocks, and then copy the first 10 values from the sorted array into a new array of winners. Does this algorithm remind you of the days at school? Let's see what the same task looks like in LINQ. First, I will provide a local function that converts an integer value into a sequence of 6-digit blocks. I will repeat that iteration, but this time I yield return each block. Then comes the expression that will calculate the 10 most frequent blocks of digits. Are you ready? Start from the data, use the select menu operator with a two blocks strategy to extract all stretches of digits, group them by the value, but only retain the block itself and the count of its appearances. I don't care about the appearances themselves, so I don't collect them. Then sort descending by count. Pull out the blocks only. Take 10 items from the head, those are the 10 most frequent blocks of digits. Collect them into an array, and with that, end the expression. This expression is shorter and much simpler than the previous algorithm. How will it fare when I run the benchmark? Would it surprise you to learn that the declarative link version was significantly faster than the imperative one? That is so typical when it comes to complex expressions. I wasn't cheating, by the way. I used the best of my knowledge to implement the algorithm. Yet, LINQ has beaten me single-handedly. How? The answer is in the data structures LINQ uses under the hood. Those are not the dictionaries, lists, and hash sets you might expect. LINQ has its own data structures, private classes you cannot access. Those collections would be unsafe to use outside of LINQ. Still, they give the power to LINQ to model and remodel the data very efficiently before producing a result or a sequence of results. That is how LINQ will beat you more often than not when it comes to writing complex expressions. Therefore, LINQ is fast. If anybody tells you otherwise, ask for their benchmarks. That will make them go away.